Hello, welcome to another genetic algorithms video. Boy, I seem to be making a lot of these genetic algorithms videos recently. In this video, I'm going to explore something called interactive selection. A lot of ideas behind interactive selection pioneered by Carl Sims. Here is a reference to an artwork, a project created in 1997. It's a museum exhibit. You can look kind of here at this image. And what you see in this image are a lot of screens. And these screens are displaying images. And then you see along the floor here all these sensors. So a viewer at this museum exhibit would come and stand in front of an image. And when the viewer is standing in front of the image and looking at the image, they're standing on the sensor. And some type of counter or some type of algorithmic system is keeping track of how long the viewer is standing on top of that sensor. Why is all this happening? OK, so I've said before, when I've talked about using a genetic algorithm in a project, I've said there are two main things that are really up to you to design, that your sort of creative input into what's going to happen in your project. One is this idea of a genotype versus phenotype, which is also a really sort of key factor in the Carl Sims project that I'm showing to you and the thing that I'm going to demonstrate and make for you as well. But really what I'm talking about right now is this fitness function. And the reason why I've come over here on the whiteboard to kind of write that down is usually the next thought from here is, what is the math formula for the fitness? Well, it's, you know, inverse distance squared divided by the amount of time it took to do this and the blah, 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 blah. You're coming up with some kind of number of characters correct, blah, 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 some type of actual mathematical function. Well, in this case, there is nothing other than the amount of time a viewer spent looking at a particular image. So in this case, it's the behavior of the visitor to the exhibit that is driving the fitness function. And you could think of this in a lot of other ways. You could have a rating system. You know, the fitness of a particular piece of music is the amount of star ratings it got on some, you know, music sharing web service type of thing. So user input into the fitness, user-driven design, right? You could be saying, I want to design a particular pattern for a dress, but instead of hand making that design, I'm going to just have a program algorithmically generate 100 designs. I'm going to look at them, pick the ones I like, and generate 100 new designs. So you could evolve where you are essentially the designer assigning fitness to the things in the evolutionary system. And that's what's happening here in this particular exhibit. So how would you do that? I mean, this is really all I have to say. This video is really more about this idea. And actually, this it becomes, you know, there's so many possibilities. Do I write a web application, or do I create something with computer vision? And perhaps I can explore, if you have some suggestions, some particular scenarios. But I have for you just to look at some code and see an example happening. I have perhaps what might be the lamest version of interactive selection ever. And I'm going to show you this example and talk you through the code a little bit. So this is the example right here. And what it has that you can see if I zoom in here is a bunch of different designs for faces. And as you can see, as I hover my mouse over them, I am incrementing a number. So I'm saying here, like, this, I really, really like this particular face design. So I have these designs. I have about, I think there's 10 of them here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And I've given them all a rating. And then I have a button here that I can press, Evolve Next Generation. And I click that button. And you can see I now have a new generation of designs from the ones that got a high rating. And I can say, you know what? I love purple. Let's give this one a high rating. But the size of this one's pretty good. And let's hit Evolve. And you can see I've got a lot of purple ones now. So again, and I can keep hitting Evolve. And you're going to see there's some mutation at play and things happening. I'm not suggesting to you that there's anything particularly revolutionary about this, but it is showing you the basic mechanics of this system. So let's think about how this works. Number one is I'm using some form of interaction, like a rollover, to increment the fitness value for a particular face. And then I also have this idea of a design. So there's also this question here of, there was nothing written there. There's also this question here of genotype versus phenotype. So in Carl Sims' example, if you read the paper that I have linked in this video's description, there's an elaborate discussion of how the images in the exhibition are created out of these kind of like mathematical formula sequences written in the programming language Lisp and all sorts of craziness like that. But what I'm actually doing in my particular example, which is quite a technique that you can apply, is I actually have a DNA. The DNA is actually just a sequence of floating point numbers. And each floating point number is between 0 and 1. So that is the signature for the design. And if I go, you can see we have this idea of genotype and phenotype, if I look at the code very briefly. In in DNA.js, you can see this is the genotype right here. This is the data. An array of genes, everything with a random number between 0 and 1. And then the expression of that data is in the face object. And the face object right here, you can see that expression happening here. So this face object has a lot of parts of its design. It has a radius, an eye x and y position, a size of the eyes, an eye color, the mouth position, the mouth width, the mouth height. And all of those things are taking these numbers between 0 and 1 and mapping them to some other range, like a color between 0 and 255, or a position between 25 and 60, that type of thing. So this is one way of taking this idea of data and then mapping it to a bunch of variables, which then draw this kind of ridiculous design of a face with a couple rectangles. So I think that you, as a person watching this video, probably could come up with a much more creative or beautiful or interesting type of design. Perhaps you can think of it as like a vector-based shape of paths, or you could think of other ways of encoding your design. Maybe it's a piece of music, so it's not actually even a visual design, it's a sequence of notes and rhythms. But whatever that is, then you just need a rating system. And in this case, I had to have this rollover function that whenever the user is rolling over that particular object, the fitness is going up by some small amount. Pretty arbitrary, but you could have a drop-down menu to assign ratings. But one of the things that I think is kind of key to realize about this kind of system, so if I go back to show you just really, really briefly, if I go back to this Shakespeare example, right? The Shakespeare example, look at this. In the time I talked there, I evolved 175 generations, each population having 200 elements. Let me run this example for you again. And there's 10 elements in the population, and I'm clicking around. Oh, and I've got to actually rate some, and I got 8 generations with 10 elements. So this scale here is a bit of a problem. While with this kind of numeric fitness function, a mathematical calculation, I could just be churning out generation after generation after generation after generation over and over again. But here I've got to look at it, I've got to evaluate it, I've got to think about it, I've got to roll over it, then I've got to click the button. So scale is an issue, but one thing you might think about is the web, the network, a distributed network of viewers. Could you create some type of system? Maybe you could have a website, by the way, that has a different design. This is kind of an awful idea, but you know, you have a website where you want somebody to buy something, or think of something besides buy. You just want someone to download a nice flower image, because that's going to make the world a better place. What if you showed a different design each time somebody came to the website, and the sort of rating of that design was how likely that, whether or not that person got to sort of some end result of using the website. You can think of it as, this kind of ties into this idea of reinforcement learning. But you could evolve a particular design through users' kind of unconscious behavior of just kind of using a particular website, whether it's intuitive or not, or playing a game. There's lots of possibilities besides just rating. But the point is, if you have something up on the web, you can have a lot of people rating and evolving all at the same time with like a centralized database. Anyway, I'm rambling on and on and on in this video. You can find this code linked to in the description of the video. I hope that you maybe try to make your own evolutionary design system with interactive selection and share it with me. And so we can see what kind of new and creative ideas. And maybe if you share some with me, I'll come back and make a video where I show some of them so that you guys can see what other people have been making. Okay, see you soon in another video soon. I got one more genetic algorithm video at least coming in the pipeline here that'll be after this one in the playlist. Okay, goodbye.